Right. The national question in the IWG. I mean, Lawless functioned as a stage Irishman on the British left. He never ceased to function as such. And he made a thing about the national question. You know, the national question was us, it was him. And for example, he played that role in relation to IS. He worked with IS centrally, closely, until the troops were sent into to Northern Ireland. Mm. Then he had a division with them. He and I were on the same side, but that's a different question. But I mean, nationalism is a degree of blindness for the working class. It doesn't, now, by nationalism, I mean the ideology. I take it for granted that always and everywhere we're for national rights, freedom, including for the nation we happen to belong to, if it's oppressed. That was never an issue in the Irish Workers Group.
Well, we're agreed on that the ideology of nationalism. We are not ideological. I mean, I am not an ideological nationalist, but it is very careful. You know, it is this. There is this problem that's, and I think you know we have it in Lenin, we have it Trotsky, that you know that some nationalisms that are either, if you like, a nationalism is a sort of alloy of a number of strands and things bringing it up. A lot of nationalisms are alike, but no nationalism can be exactly the same, obviously. And in a national confrontation, there are often two nationalisms: one, the oppressor nationalism, sure. One, the oppressed nationalism. Yeah. And the oppressed nationalism has this positive side, has demands in it that you can support where you can't support it.
And of course, at
times, you know, it's difficult to tell which national. I mean, I always think today the Ukrainian-Russian division is something that you can only make pacifist demands on.
Surely we're for Ukrainian independence if they want to.
Oh, yes, for Ukrainian independence, certainly. Ukraine is independent. It is not part of it, but then part of it is being held. Part of it, which seems to be mainly Russian, is being populated, is held by Russia. So what do you do? You know, and of course there's also the fixed question of the fascists open fascists.
I don't think that's relevant. Even fascists of an oppressed nation
have
the right. You want to shoot them as fascists.
Yeah,
but I mean you don't think that because they are involved in it, it invalidates. It doesn't.
I think so, but as I say, there has been. In fact, the people I most sympathise with are the Crimean Tatars, yes. But that's another story. But this is the thing, and the formulation I thought that you had was that that nationalism, yeah, it's bad, but you don't clarify that it is that there may be the subtle differences, and that many of the demands are from an internationalist and democratic point of view can be correct. And this, I think, is something that the LWR, who, let's face it, were not exactly the most dialectical of people at that time, never did, I think, become. I mean, certainly they wouldn't have been with Lambert. They really understood.
I'm only dimly acquainted with some of their stuff. But can we go back to the national question? Lenin put it well in terms of our attitude to nationalism when he said that the nationalism of an oppressed is not the same as the nationalism of an oppressor nation.
Okay,
but
yeah.
All nationalism is alien to us because the oppressed very often, first of all, it's not uncommon to find in the territory claimed by the oppressed peoples who themselves can be oppressed. That's particularly true in the ex-colonies. So, and oppressed people can be chauvinists. And our fundamental attitude is we have our own programme, which is a consistently democratic programme. For example, it might lead to cantonisation, degrees of local control in the disputed area in the Ukraine or in parts of Northern Ireland. But we have our own programme, We are consistent Democrats, again, that's Lenin's expression, and we consistently support progressive demands of oppressed people. We take it for granted they have a right, a democratic right, to independence if they want it.
Well, the point I would make there is that that side of it, for a whole period, the democratic demands that might coincide with nationalist demands, that there could be, that such demands could exist, were tended to be ignored and denied by the LWR.
Again, I am not sure what period you're talking about.
So 69, the early 68, 69, to about perhaps about 71. I think it sort of to be was sort of stripping off in 71 of it.
But none of us understood what was going to happen in the North.
Nobody understood, but they did not see, if you raised questions like that, it was simply, the Healyite thing, and presumably the Lambertists, though I've never argued with the Lambertists per se, that's nationalist, it's just sort of...
I've written a series of articles in our paper, it's on the internet, about the left in 69.
Well, yeah, I know, I got them. Martin sent me. Are those the ones Martin sent me?
I guess so, I don't know.
I read them, yeah.
Well, I mean, the Healyites, the Gerry-Healyites, they were, entirely crazy in some of the things they said. They were, B, pandering to Protestants under the cover of being virtuously anti-imperialists. Mm. And they were completely erratic. They had no basic principles. They just went to a reaction against what was going on. And they were frequently bonkers.
You know? But when I say that that the line was Healy, I mean their approach, if you like, was Healyite. That you don't talk about things. It's nationalist. It's like talking to paedophiles or something. It was pretty silent. Healy had this awful phrase, a Trotskyist would rather die than do such and such a thing.
Who was it?
Healy. Paddy Healy?
Paddy.
Paddy Healy, yeah.
Well, I've never heard that.
Well, I did, believe me.
But I mean, Paddy joined the Lambertists. Now, which was the most stupid Trotskyist group? I used to think it was Millicent, the Socialist Party. Well, actually, it might very well be the Lambertists. And Paddy and company joined the Lambertists, and they acted as a conduit for Lambertist ideas.
Yeah.
I mean, for example, they had this magic solution where they called for the Constituent Assembly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, that was ridiculous, because a Constituent Assembly, to have any effect, would have to have the agreement of everybody involved, mm-hmm, to be guided by the outcome, if there was a positive outcome. And, I mean, it's like, well, how do you catch a bird? Salt in his tail. But if you can put salt in your tail, you can grab it. And if you can get a Constituent Assembly, with the Protestants and the Unionists involved, to work to discuss a constitution for a common Ireland, if you can get that, then you've already solved the problem. So to postulate as a solution to the problem, something that itself presupposes the problem has been solved, which is ridiculous. But I mean, by that stage, I think there were seriously, So one of the things that might be useful, I'm going to say discuss our relation with the LWR, but Saor Éire, I mean, you get a lot of comments on Peter and Saor Éire, that the Saor Éire episode was an expression of the Mandelite people who wanted to use guerrilla warfare in Europe, or at least discuss it, people like Daniel Bensardenton.
Mm-hmm.
And it's all nonsense.
Of course it's nonsense, if anything. Peter, it was the other way around, wasn't it?
Peter had no contact with any of the Mandelites, unless you want to include me as a sympathiser.
Until he moved to London.
Yes.
On the
but
run.
But he moved to London because of the Guard of Fire.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you get an awful... Oh,
absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, that I have pointed that out myself, but Yeah. How do you...
Well, you get, for example, there's a book-length polemic by Jerry Foley, SWP America.
I know that. That would be
73.
That would be the thing. I corrected him on that, actually. Perhaps I should have sent a public letter. Difficult to... at that time I was General Secretary. Anyway, General Secretary of the Revolutionary Marxist Group. You just have to write whatever. And trying to work out the position on... what was that? Oh, yes, the Cruz O'Brien business. Anyway, I probably should have. But anyway, I did write a letter to him saying, you're wrong, it was the other way around. And he sort of said that... forget what he said. Jerry Foley wasn't the worst, I must say. But I did firmly. But I don't think that is now good coin in the... in the international, but I haven't heard it for years. But I think some of the groups may have raised it again. But that was in 73.
By the way, one of the oddest things in his polemic is he says permanent revolution means that there is no possible reform that imperialism carry out. Now this was. When the Sunnyland agreement was being worked out. So it's ridiculous. But I mean, it's an example of permanent revolution reducing your brain power.